He's an Argentinean-American Jewish Christian. He's a husband and father of four kids. In the sixth grade, he began reading about cryptozoology, UFOs, and the occult. Later, he attended a private Jewish school and had his bar mitzvah in Israel. In a search for truth, it took him down the path of New Age practices, including Eastern spirituality via martial arts. Now he speaks for Christianity and against the New Age and against Eastern spirituality. He's taught Christian apologetics at Calvary Chapel for many years, and he's involved in research, writing, and lecturing on Christian apologetics and related topics for over a decade. And he's authored approximately 2,000 essays on Christian apologetics, which are available on his website, www.truthfreethinker.com. Please give a hand for Mariano.
Thank you, Terry. And I'd like to make a pitch for a lecture in the past. If you were here for the last lecture we gave, you're fortunate, because I've known Terry for about a decade, and that was the only time he's not been too busy to actually present a lecture. So that was wonderful, and when they get it up on the website, I highly recommend you view it. Well, tonight's topic is going to be about the multiverse theory. And since I'm not an astronomer and I'm not a cosmetologist, I wondered how I would be... Okay, that's just a little joke for my sister's sake, actually. If you didn't catch it, just so you know, cosmologists deal with the universe. Cosmetologists deal with the unibrow. So there's a little slight distinction there in fields. So I'd actually like to start by pointing out that a famous person once stated that when understanding of the universe has become widespread, Christian doctrine will be convicted of absurdity. So that's something to keep in mind as we go on. Now, what we're covering tonight is defined variously, and there's a lot of different terms for the subject. Some use the term multiverse, or many worlds, or world ensembles, ensemble of universes, universe domain, branching universes. So you'll run across a lot of different terms for variations on the theory that there is more than one universe. So that's the topic, is whether there is more than one universe. And you can see by this illustration one of the ideas, which is that universes just bubble up, and some of them would fizzle out right away, some of them would grow to a certain stage of maturity, and some would eventually, and inevitably, so it is claimed, produce life. Yeah, I can't seem to get it to go to the next one. There it goes. Here's another idea. This is the oscillating universe. So what is happening here is the universe, a big bang occurs. The universe expands, grows, and eventually it collapses back down and into a big crunch. And then into a big bang, it expands and grows, and then a big crunch. And so the concept is that the universe is eternal in that it has many permutations. It's big crunch, big bang, big crunch, big bang, over and over and over, infinitely, eternally. Of course, you could tell that this idea, if you're interested in the question of how did the universe come to be, of course, this doesn't answer anything. It just keeps pushing the explanation backwards in time, because it's just eternal fluctuations, oscillations. There's no such thing as what caused it. It's just eternal. This is another concept, basically, that there's various universes, but they're in dimensions. So these are just sort of stacked. Different dimensions, different universes. This is another concept, which is basically that black holes lead into white holes, and that's how universes are made from each other and how they can exist in different domains. And multiverses have a very long history and are very popular in pop culture. You can see from one of the illustrations that it's known in Hinduism. And then you have them in DC Comics, Marvel Comics. Jet Li's movie, The One, was very interesting. In the movie, there's multiverses, and he realizes that his energy spread throughout them in his various selves. So he decides to travel to each of the universes, killing himself, and he becomes more and more and more powerful. And it's an action movie, but it's pretty fun as far as the sci-fi is concerned. And the very last scene of the movie is pretty interesting if you've ever been involved in martial arts, because it's basically hard against soft, or internal versus external. I think it's Jing Yi versus Bag Hua. It's pretty much an interesting movie if you're into that kind of thing. And then these are more recent examples. The TV shows Flash Forward, Fringe, and Lost all played upon the concept of the multiverse. And of course, by the end of Lost, we found out that show was really about universalism, but that's another lecture. And so this documentary called What the Bleep Do We Know has a special place in my heart. Because I had a friend tell me, oh, if you want to be up on the latest science, you have to watch this documentary. And, I did. And if you want to be up on the latest science, I guess it means that you'd watch this documentary that's presented by, it covers the idea of quantum physics, and it's presented by a New Age spirit channeler. It's not even the human being in the movie. It actually claims to be the spirit channeling through her, an anesthesiologist, a radiologist, and a chiropractor who's a follower of the New Age medium. And they throw in a couple of physicists for good measure, by the way. But one of them's a self-employed physicist and wrote the book, The Yoga of Time Travel. So anyhow, actually, what was interesting is both of the physicists made the point that we create our own realities, and they both wore glasses. And I'm thinking, why would you want to have poor eyesight? I just talk about theory not matching reality. There it was. But this movie touches upon a concept of the multiverse, which is really based on an interpretation of quantum physics, which is that, for instance, if you were to come to a fork in the road, you decide to turn right, well, at the same time, another reality opens up where you turned left. And so now you have two of yourselves traveling these two roads, and your lives take very different turns based on these decisions. Although I've not been able to figure out what gauges the level of decision. I mean, did a branch universe just open up now because I could have chosen to scratch my left ear, but I didn't? So in another universe, I scratch my left ear? Or is it, forks in the road? Is it, what level of decision causes these universes to branch out? I've not been able to determine that. I don't know if anybody has proposed a sort of scale. This one opens up a brand new universe. This level of decision doesn't. I don't know. And I'm afraid that these ideas are definitely make for some fascinating sci-fi, no question about it. I'm a big sci-fi fan, but the problem is it takes on a life of its own, and the way also it filters down through popular culture and popular science reporting, such as an example here from Scientific American, where Alejandro Jenkins and Gilad Perez write, "Multiple other universes, each with its own laws of physics, may have emerged from the same primordial vacuum that gave rise to ours. Assuming they exist, many of those universes may contain intricate structures and perhaps even some form of life. These findings suggest that our universe may not be as finely tuned for the emergence of life as previously thought." I wonder if you caught something odd about that. I mean, the concept is odd. of itself, but let me read it again with a little emphasis. Multiple other universes, each with its own laws of physics, may have emerged from the same primordial vacuum that gave rise to ours. Assuming they exist, many of those universes may contain intricate structures and perhaps even some forms of life. These findings suggest that our universe, blah, blah, blah. These findings, what findings? That may have, that assuming, that may contain, and that, oh, these findings. Okay, so we're jumping to conclusions based on really nothing. And that's the major theme of the multiverse issue, is the conclusions are fascinating and exciting, and they make for good sci-fi. But really, what are they based on? So I'd like to go over, read quite a few quotations, because I'm from the horse's mouth kind of guy. And have you ever, by the way, had a dyslexic try to read to you? Yeah, this should be fun. So let's start with considering the pre-Big Bang scenario. And I want you to pay attention to the premise upon which these comments are made, the point of view from which they're coming, because we're supposed to be dealing with unbiased science, right? So Andre Linde inflationary universe states, the most difficult aspect of this problem is not the existence of the singularity itself, but the question of what was before the singularity. This problem lies somewhere at the boundary between physics and metaphysics. And John Gribben in Nature wrote, the biggest problem with the Big Bang theory of the origin of the universe is philosophical, perhaps even theological. What was there before the bang? And John Maddox in Nature wrote, apart from being philosophically unacceptable, the Big Bang is an oversimplified view of how the universe began, and it is unlikely to survive the decade ahead. And this was written in 1989, by the way. In all respects, save that of convenience, this view of the origin of the universe is thoroughly unsatisfactory. For one thing, the implication is that there was an instant at which time literally began, and so, by extension, an instant before which there was no time. That, in turn, implies that even if the origin of the universe may be successfully supposed to lie in the Big Bang, the origin of the Big Bang itself is not susceptible to discussion. It is an effect whose cause cannot be identified or even discussed. Even the notion that the present appearance of the universe may represent but one cycle in the oscillation of a universe whose total mass is enough to hold it together gravitationally, which seems unlikely, would not resolve the philosophical difficulty that an important issue, that of the ultimate origin of the world, cannot be discussed. Now, Gottgun, Shroom, and Tinsley in Scientific American write, the universe began from a state of infinite density about one Hubble time ago. Space and time were created in that event, and so was all matter in the universe. It is not meaningful to ask what happened before the Big Bang. It is somewhat like asking what is north of the North Pole. Similarly, it is not sensible to ask where the Big Bang took place. The point universe was not an object isolated in space. It was the entire universe. And so the only answer can be that the Big Bang happened everywhere. Arthur Eddington in Nature and the Physical World. This is a topic on which science is silent, and all that one can say is prejudice. And Hans Ofken in Anti-Worlds, Anti-Matter, and Cosmology states, we beg leave to sidestep the question, what happened before then? John Post, in Metaphysics of Contemporary Introduction, states, by definition, the universe contains everything there is or was or will be. And if that sounds familiar, of course, Carl Sagan seconded that in Cosmos. The cosmos is all there is or ever was or ever will be. and Bertrand Russell in The Existence of God states, the universe is just there and that's all. And incidentally, I'm not sure we've progressed in the least bit beyond that statement. Now, let us keep going along this route of considering the premise of these point of views and touch upon the steady state theory while we're at it. And the quotes will explain the steady state theory. John Gribben, again in Nature, the biggest problem with the Big Bang theory of the origin of the universe is philosophical, perhaps even theological. What was there before the Big Bang? This problem alone was sufficient to give great impetus to the steady state theory. But with that theory now sadly in conflict with the observation, the best way around this initial difficulty is provided by a model in which the universe expands from a singularity, collapses back again, and repeats the cycle infinitely, indefinitely. Martin Rees in Before the Beginning makes a reference to the steady state theory. For him, and here he's referring to his mentor, Dennis Chiama, as for its inventors, it had a deep philosophical appeal. The universe existed from everlasting to everlasting in a uniquely self-consistent state. When conflicting evidence emerged, Chiama therefore sought a loophole, even an unlikely seeming one, rather as a defense lawyer clutches at any argument to rebut the persecution case. And Dennis Chiama himself stated the following, as quoted in Simon Tsai's book, The Big Bang, The Origin of the Universe, "For me, the loss of the steady state theory has been a cause of great sadness. The steady state theory has a sweep and beauty that for some unaccountable reason, the architect of the universe appears to have overlooked." Another classic. Arno Penzias, in Genius Talk, Conversations with Nobel Scientists and Other Luminaries, states, "Well, some people are uncomfortable with the purposefully created world. To come up with things that contradict purpose, they tend to speculate about things they haven't seen." And Robert Jastrow, in God and the Astronomers, states, some scientists aren't happy with the idea that the world began this way. Until recently, and that was written in 1978, many of my colleagues preferred the steady state theory, which holds that the universe had no beginning and is eternal." And Stanley Jackie, in Science and Creation, stated the following about Sir Fred Hoyle, who proposed the steady state theory. And it is that such theories were based on, quote unquote, openly anti-theological or rather anti-Christian motivations. And Stephen Brush in Scientific America notes, "Many scientists, particularly in Britain, liked the simplicity of the steady state theory and so continued to cling to the concept. They pointed out that one did not have to make arbitrary assumptions about a Big Bang or worry about what happened before the Big Bang." And going on with this, Robert Dickey in Astrophysical Journal, this states that the steady state theory, quote, "relieves us of the necessity of understanding the origin of matter at any finite time in the past." And Christopher Isham in Physics, Philosophy, and Theology, A Common Quest for Understanding states, "perhaps the best argument in favor of the thesis that the Big Bang supports theism is the obvious unease with which it is greeted by some atheist physicists. At times, this has led to scientific ideas such as a continuous creation, which is the steady state, or an oscillating universe, being advanced with a tenacity which so exceeds their intrinsic worth that one can only suspect the operation of psychological forces lying very much deeper than the usual academic desire of a theorist to support his or her theory." Now, the steady state theory proper might have been disproved, but I must say, in another way, in a certain manner speaking, it is more popular than ever. Now, it might not be the actual technical steady state theory proper, but the idea that matter is eternal and therefore the universe is eternal is, I think, more popular than ever. And I'll give you an example of it right now. This is from a debate between Brian Sapient and Kelly O'Connor of the Rational Response Squad versus Kirk Cameron and Ray Comfort of The Way of the Master.
That tells us scientifically, if we were to use a more scientific approach, that the components of our world today, our universe, have always existed. And we have real science to lend credence to that. Knowing that, and knowing that the other side of the coin is to create something to explain it away. This is called, in logic terms, an argument from ignorance. Ray doesn't know what created the world, so he's made up a god to tell you that that is what's created the world. You know, knowing that, that we have these two options. One thing that we don't have any proof for, that we just make up. And another one, that we have this scientific theory, this law, actually, that's been tested over and over and over and has never been shown wrong. All signs point to the fact that the universe has just always existed and no god is needed to explain it. And if you're a philosophy buff, you would have heard of this term, Occam's razor. And Occam's razor tells us that the most simplest solution is the most plausible. And in this case, the simplest solution is no god.
First, a little point of clarification. He referred to the third law of thermodynamics. He's really referring to the first, but just taking the statement as it is. So you see his point. Is matter is eternal, the universe is eternal. And I mean, that's what I mean. This is out there. This is, like I said, perhaps more popular than ever with the advent of the internet. I personally think that the explanation is extremely simple, which is that when you're talking about the laws of thermodynamics, you're talking about within the box, right? I mean, you're talking about within the universe. You're talking about a law that functions in here, okay? I mean, and that's the issue when you're talking about science and the laws we know. That's what you're talking about. It doesn't necessitate that the matter or the universe is eternal, but that once you have the universe, now inside that box, yes, that law applies as far as we know. And in fact, I believe that this is predicted in the Bible itself, this first law of thermodynamics, right in Genesis 2, 1 through 3. Thus, the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work, which God had created and made. And so there you have it. God was working on his creation, and at a certain point in time, it's done, it's finished. And there's the law, first law of thermodynamics. No more energy, no more matter. It was there, and there it is, finished, done. A finite amount. Now, let me go back to Robert Jastrow, who states that theologians generally are delighted with the proof that the universe had a beginning, but astronomers are curiously upset. Their reaction provides an interesting demonstration of the response of the scientific mind, supposedly a very objective mind, when evidence uncovered by science itself leads to a conflict with the articles of faith in our profession. It turns out that the scientist behaves the way the rest of us do when our beliefs are in conflict with the evidence. We become irritated, we pretend the conflict does not exist, or we paper it over with meaningless phrases. Some prominent scientists began to feel that the same irritation over the expanding universe that Einstein had expressed earlier. Arthur Eddington wrote in 1931, "I have no axe to grind in this discussion, but the notion of a beginning is repugnant to me. I simply do not believe that the present order of things started off with a bang. The expanding universe is preposterous, incredible. It leaves me cold." The German chemist Walter Nernst wrote, "To deny the infinite duration of time would be to betray the very foundation of science." More recently, Philip Morris of MIT stated in a BBC film on cosmology, "I find it hard to accept the Big Bang theory. I would like to reject it." And Alan Sandage of Palomar Observatory, who established the uniformity of the expansion of the universe out to nearly 10 billion light years, said, "It is such a strange conclusion. It could not really be true." Einstein wrote, "The scientist is possessed by a sense of universal causation. This religious faith of the scientist is violated by the discovery that the world had a beginning under conditions in which the known laws of physics are not valid. And as a product of forces or circumstances we cannot discover. When that happens, the scientist has lost all control. If he really examined the implications, he would be traumatized." So now, let's make a little point about what we're really dealing with, which is models, right? That's what we're dealing with, is cosmological models. And of course, a model is a model. You can model anything you'd like at all. Let me give you an example here. This is from the movie Men in Black, the very end of it.
Rodman, you're kidding.
Nope.
Not much of a disguise.
Steve, I don't want him playing. Watch, guys, watch. Gorgeous. So that's wonderful. In that scenario, our galaxy, our universe, is inside of a little marble with which an alien is playing. Again, you can model anything. So let's go into a consideration of modeling. Roger Penrose stated the following in a broadcast of Unbelievable. He's referring to The Grand Design, by the way, by Stephen Hawking. "What is referred to as M-theory isn't even a theory. It's a collection of ideas, hopes, aspirations. I think the book is a bit misleading in that respect. It gives you the impression that here in this new theory, which is going to explain everything, it's nothing of the sort. I think the book suffers rather more strongly than many. It's not an uncommon thing in popular descriptions of science to latch onto some idea, particularly things to do with string theory, which have absolutely no support from observation. They're just nice ideas that people have tried to explore." And Stephen Hawking and Leonard Mlodinow state in the book Grand Design, they make a point about what they call model-dependent realism. And here's how they describe it. "The idea that our brains interpret the input from our sensory organs by making a model of the world. There is no picture or theory independent concept of reality. A physical theory or world picture is a model, generally of a mathematical nature, and a set of rules that connect the elements of the model to observation. This provides a framework with which to interpret modern science. It is pointless to ask whether a model is real, only whether it agrees with observation. There is no model independent test of reality. It follows that a well-constructed model creates a reality of its own." And they go on. "It might be that to describe the universe, we have to employ different theories in different situations. Each theory may have its own version of reality, but according to model-dependent realism, this is acceptable so long as the theory agree in their predictions, whether they overlap, that is, whether they can both be applied. And when it comes to, quote unquote, those who maintain that the account given in Genesis is literally true, and the view according to which, quote unquote, time continues back 13.7 billion years to the Big Bang, they conclude that while, quote unquote, the Big Bang theory is more useful than the first, still, neither model can be said to be more real than the other." And so, dealing in models is the reason we end up with things such as imaginary time, which is the brief history of time was based on the concept of imaginary time. So that, again, we're dealing with models. And it's a bottom line kind of issue. Cliff Burgess and Fernando Quevedo in Scientific American state, "Various types of parallel universes that make up a grand multiverse often arise as a side effect of cosmological theories. We have little hope of ever directly observing those other universes, though. because they are either too far away or somehow detached from our own universe. And that's really one of the bottom line issues with the multiverse theory, is that our sample size is one, period. If they're out there, we might never know. So to assume that they're out there because our theories or our models say so, that's a whole different category. I mean, that's a whole separate issue. Now, Max Tegmark in Scientific American states, here's how far we're going with this, by the way. Is there a copy of you? The idea of such an alter ego seems strange and implausible, but it looks as if we will just have to live with it, because it is supported by astronomical observation. In infinite space, even the most unlikely event must take place somewhere. There are infinitely many other inhabited planets, including not just one, but infinitely many that have people with the same appearances, name, and memories as you, who play out every possible permutation of your life's choices. The concept of the universe is grounded in well-tested theories. Actually, let me stop there a second. That's supported by astronomical observations? Well, show it to me. I mean, what astronomical observation concludes that there's someone out there with the same appearance, name, and memories as me? I'd just like to see it. That's all. He continues, the concept of a multiverse is grounded in well-tested theories such as relativity and quantum mechanics, and it fulfills both of the basic criteria of empirical science. It makes predictions, and it can be falsified. The key question is not whether the multiverse exists, but rather how many levels does it have? And to this particular remark, George Ellis states in his lecture, A Critique of Multiverses, Tegmark is giving us untested speculation, including the casual assumption of truly existing infinite past off, of truly existing infinities passed off as established fact. I think this is completely irresponsible writing, and I think it's unscientific stuff being attempting to be passed off as science. And in his lecture, The Multiverse, Ultimate Causation in God, George Ellis states, the very nature of the scientific enterprise is at stake in the multiverse debate, because multiverse components weaken the nature of scientific proof in order to claim multiverses provide a scientific explanation. In my view, this is a very dangerous tactic. What we are told, what people would like us to believe, is that known physics leads to the multiverse. The true situation is that known physics is extrapolated to hypothetical physics, which leads to the multiverse. The multiverse is not the result of known physics, but is the result of a major extrapolation of known physics to an untested domain. And it is that untested extrapolation which leads to the multiverse. People are proposing to us we should place theory above observation, and this is a dangerous trend in science, which we are seeing in the multiverse. Let me go backwards a little bit. This is a dangerous trend in science, which we are seeing in the multiverse, is people telling us, don't worry about what the observation, worry about my theory. And he goes on in his lecture, A Critique of the Multiverse, belief in the multiverse is an exercise in faith. Does a multiverse in fact exist? I have no idea. I think you can believe what you want. What do you find aesthetic? What gives you comfort? What do you like? And Martin Gardner, in Our Universe is Thicker Than a Blackberry, states, the stark truth is that there is not the slightest shred of reliable evidence that there's any universe other than the one we are in. No multiverse theory has so far provided a prediction that can be tested. In my layman's opinion, they are all frivolous fantasies. As far as we can tell, universes are not even as plentiful as two blackberries. Surely, the conjecture that there is just one universe and its creator is infinitely simpler and easy to believe than that there are countless billions upon billions of worlds constantly increasing in number and created by nobody. I can only marvel at the low state to which today's philosophy of science has fallen. And how far has it fallen? You know the story about the discussion as to upon what does the earth rest? And somebody stated, well, it's on the back of a turtle. So they were asked, well, and what is the turtle resting on? They said, well, another turtle. Said, and what's that turtle resting on? And finally, they just get frustrated and say, it's just turtles all the way down. And now today, in this technologically advanced age of science, we're basically just being told it's not turtles all the way down, it's multiverses all the way down. I mean, it's the same thing. It's just a non-explanation to explain a real issue. It's just multiverses all the way down. That's all it is. Where did the universe come from? The multiverse. Where did the multiverse come from? The multiverse. There's just no end in sight. It's an infinite regress. And that explains nothing. So now, we got some hints thus far, but let's get to the real meat of the motivations behind the multiverse theory. From various perspectives, let's start with Scott Todd in the journal Nature, who states, even if all the data pointed to an intelligent designer, such a hypothesis is excluded from science because it is not naturalistic. Incidentally, I think the real problem with that statement is if all the data really did point to an intelligent designer, then science would accommodate that bit of data. I mean, science would change, its methods would be applied to it. I mean, he's really talking about a naturalistic worldview that will not allow a divine foot in the door, as Richard Lewontin put it. Amanda Gefter in New Scientist states, if this theory doesn't pan out, our only other option is a supernatural one, is to abandon science itself. And Leonard Siskin in New Scientist states, as things stand now, we will be in a very awkward position. Without any explanation of nature's fine-tuning, we will be hard-pressed to answer the ID critics. And ID there, by the way, is intelligent design. And further evidence of these sort of motivations, Bernard Carr and Universal Multiverse. To the hardline physicist, the multiverse may not be entirely respectable, but it is at least preferable to invoking a creator. Indeed, anthropically inclined physicists like Leonard Susskind and Steven Weinberg are attracted to the multiverse precisely because it seems to dispense with God as an explanation of cosmic design. And in a footnote to that statement, he writes, it should be cautioned that the concept of cosmic design being described here has nothing to do with the intelligent design movement in the USA. Nevertheless, atheists might hope that the multiverse theory will have the same impact in the context of cosmic design than the theory of evolution did in the context of biological design. And this is another very popular position, by the way, is to marry Darwinism with the multiverse. And they refer to it in the exact same terms. Out of all these bubbling up universes, which ones survive, which ones fizzle out? It's natural selection. I mean, it's all the same thing. And he hopes that it will do for cosmic design as the theory of evolution did in the context of biological design. Well, what has it done? Let's see. Francis Crick in What Mad Pursuit states, my biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved. And Richard Dawkins in The Blind Watchmaker, biology is the study of complicated things that give the appearance of having been designed for a purpose. Okay, so in other words, first you deny the evidence, then when you find you can't deny it anymore, you just say, the evidence is clear, but you need to look at it through the spectacles of your worldview. And our worldview will not allow you to conclude that they were actually designed. It's just an appearance. It just seems that way. So you can imagine how this is being applied to multiverse theory. Same thing. Fine-tuning, VAT. Edward Milne in Relativity, Gravitation, and World Structure states, it has sometimes been held that these oscillating universes of general relativity provide for cycles of evolution, and for this reason, they have been favorably considered. Actually, they have not been previously analyzed in detail as regards their appearance to observation, so that it has not been previously realized how remarkably they stand in conflict with experience. They must be totally and absolutely rejected as irrational. They are fantastic weavings of mathematical looms, orgies of mathematical license, divorced from experience. They are possible only in the sense that in a dream, everything is possible. And Faye Flam in the journal Science, cosmologist Michael Turner of the University of Chicago recently coined a rule that, in a cosmological theory, you can't invoke the tooth fairy twice. His tooth fairy is not a mystical being who replaces lost teeth with quarters, but any wild, whimsical assumption dreamed up to answer some problem. In a field like cosmology, where the questions are vast and the data scarce, you would expect to have to summon a tooth fairy from time to time. But today, to hear many cosmologists talk, the population of tooth fairies is exploding. In some of the newest theories, we're inventing a new physical principle for every new observational fact, complains astronomer Mark Davies of the University of California, Berkeley. The field of cosmic structure is open up to creative speculation. And now we're getting to the bottom line. Bernard Carr in Discover states, if you don't want God, you'd better have a multiverse. Tim Folger and New Scientist, short of invoking a benevolent creator, many physicists see only one possible explanation. Our universe may be but one of perhaps infinitely many universes in an inconceivably vast multiverse. And Steven Weinberg and New Scientist, if you discover a really impressive fine-tuning, I think you'd really be left with only two explanations, a benevolent designer or a multiverse. Which incidentally, I think that these statements are classical false dichotomies. Why is it the multiverse or God? Why is it one or the other? Why couldn't God have created multiverse? Now that might step on your theological toes, but just a fact is, God could have, okay, you just put it out there, God could have done it, and so there's not this dichotomy anymore. And on the other hand, if someone attempts to argue God's non-existence with you by referencing the multiverse, give them a big old hug, because they just did you a great favor. All you have to say to them is, oh, infinite universes? Well, then surely in at least one of them God exists. Thank you very much. You just proved God's existence. There you go. So what I see in the multiverse theory, the way it's handled and the way it's interpreted, the way it's used in arguments, is that non-theists, materialists, atheists, however you want to term them, they have really created their own supernatural realm. That's really what you're dealing with. It is an unobserved and unevidenced place, a cosmos absconditus. It is intangible, it is non-disprovable, not subject to reproducible experimentation. It produces no testable predictions. Think about it. Multiverse predicts absolutely everything and anything. Anything you could imagine as being a prediction. Well, of course, they're already. There's no functional way to come up with a prediction when it's going to produce absolutely everything and anything anyway. It's able to discredit the universe, the one single one, by mere assertion. It is believed upon by faith. It's held to as a consoling delusion to escape the inconvenient reality that is supported by evidence. It is concocted as an escape mechanism. Escape from scientific evidence and theological implications. The multiverse is omnipresent. It is everywhere, all around us. It is omnipotent, containing the power to create anything and everything. It is omniscient, containing all the information that is necessary for, quote unquote, creating, populating, and maintaining various universes. It created all things, both seen and unseen, and it is the eternal uncaused first cause. I mean, this is the materialist supernatural realm. And so what kind of conclusions can we draw from the very latest in science? It is that it is ignorant and superstitious to believe that God made everything out of nothing, but it is rational and scientific to believe that nothing made everything out of nothing. It is ignorant and superstitious to believe that God is eternal, but rational and scientific to believe that matter is eternal. God is an effect and must have a cause, but matter is the uncaused first cause. If God made everything, then who made God? Matter made everything and nothing made matter. Now let's go back to Robert Jastrow one more time from his book, God and the Astronomers. And incidentally, in case you don't know, the late Professor Jastrow was the chief of the theoretical division of NASA and founder-director of NASA's Goddard Institute, professor of geophysics at Columbia University, professor of space studies, earth sciences at Dartmouth College. And he wasn't an agnostic, by the way, just so you know. And he states, "For the scientist who has lived by his faith in the power of reason, the story ends like a bad dream. He has scaled the mountains of ignorance. He's about to conquer the highest peak. As he pulls himself up over the final rock, he's greeted by a band of theologians who have been sitting there for centuries. The astronomical evidence leads to a biblical view of the origins of the world. The details differ, but the essential elements in the astronomical and biblical accounts of Genesis are the same. The chain of events leading to man commenced suddenly and sharply at a definite moment in time, in a flash of light and energy." And Arno Penzias states in the New York Times, "The best data we have concerning the Big Bang are exactly what I would have predicted if I had nothing to go on but the five books of Moses, the Psalms, and the Bible as a whole." Okay, so now, having said that, just merely as preliminary, now we get to dealing with the multiverse as a logical problem. Because like I said, not being an astronomer or a cosmologist, I wondered how could I deal with this issue? And I figured I could deal with it as a logical problem. And since this is really the heart of the lecture, the heart of the point I'm trying to make, dealing with the multiverse as a logical problem will probably take about a minute, by the way. But I couldn't say, hey, I got a 1 minute lecture, so I needed this preliminary stuff to get us to get us here. So here's the issue. There's the proposition. There's the theory. You have infinite universes, right? That's what we're being told. So I grant that. There's infinite number of universes. Granted. Okay? Each one with its own parameters, right? Granted. I'm going to grant them that. Okay, infinite number of universes, each one with its own parameters, we're granting it. Okay, now let's imagine that this one universe out of the ensemble, according to this one's parameter, there's no multiverse. Okay, we've granted that all infinite possibilities are equally valid, we're granting them that, and we're saying, well, if they're infinite, then one of them has to be that, according to this one's parameters, the multiverse doesn't exist, and you're left with nothing but a universe. So there you go. Okay? So just review that one more time. The concept is there's an infinite number of universes where absolutely everything you could imagine or could not imagine is there, is valid. So I say, fine. In one of those, according to that one, the multiverse does not actually exist, and you're just left with one. So that's a logical disproof of the multiverse theory. Okay? But now, let me argue against myself, because whenever I make an argument, I like to think about, well, how would I argue against that? And so some people say, well, an actual infinite set, it's impossible. Okay, it's impossible to prove, because if we wanted to propose that the multiverse is made up of infinite universes, there's no way to know that, because you'd go like this. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, you guessed it, 5, 6, okay. Where would you stop? You don't stop because it's infinity, right? You can't prove an infinite set for the very purpose that you could never count to infinity. So philosophically, there's no such thing as an infinite set. In which case, I think it's, we get down to the bottom line, which is just how arbitrary this is. Because let's say, well, fine, okay, I can't actually assert that the multiverse is infinite, and therefore my logical disproof holds. Okay, so tell me, of what does the multiverse consist? Oh, well, only a certain limited number of universes that are like this. And when they start to describe what they mean by like this, they're just going to throw out whatever, their favorite parameters. For instance, well, certainly God doesn't exist in any of them. Well, that's for sure. And so I say, well, but when we're considering a limited amount, my preference is that, yeah, God exists in at least one of them. I mean, it's completely arbitrary. George Ellis actually gives a lecture in which he does say, look, when we're dealing with the multiverse, we need to deal with actual universes, not potential universes. And when he describes what he means by actual, well, of course, it's a universe that is a lot like ours, because that's the only thing we could know as something that might actually be real. So in either case, if they grant you infinity, wonderful. You just are able to disprove it by pointing to that one universe according to which the multiverse doesn't exist. And that disproves it. And if they deny infinite number, then you just point out, look, we're dealing with a completely arbitrary concept. You're saying that only your preference of universes exists, and I'll say that mine do, and we don't really get anywhere. Does that make sense? Now let's point this out, that the so-called BGV theorem, Ward-Guthin-Vilenkin theorem, states that any universe which is on average in a state of cosmic expansion could not be eternal in the past, but must have an absolute beginning. And the concept is that any universe with an average Hubble expansion greater than zero will have a beginning. And if you'd like a detailed scientific explanation of precisely what that means, go ahead and ask during the Q&A time, and I'll be more than glad to let someone else explain it. But I think Paul Davies summarizes, in essence, in his interview for Australian Broadcasting Corporation, when he states, "The coming into being of the universe as discussed in modern science is not just a matter of imposing some sort of organization upon a previously incoherent state, but literally the coming into being of all physical things from nothing." And so what we're dealing with is universe, multiverse, either way, it still had to have a beginning somewhere, somehow. We're not really resolving that ultimate question by steady states or oscillations or multiverses or anything of the sort. So, now what we're coming down to is, we dealt with the multiverse, and now let's talk a little bit about, well, if we want to answer this question of ultimate origins, the universe coming into being, what could have caused the universe to come into being? What was its cause? What was its creator? And I think it's acceptable to say, on the basis of natural theology or general revelation, in which we're dealing with that which philosophy and science infers from what creation implies. What is creation telling us? What is our understanding of what creation is telling us about its cause? And since we know that time, space, and matter had a beginning, it's quite logical to suppose that, well, whatever brought it into being then was timeless, immaterial, and not, what did I say, time, so timeless, space, basically not subject to location, not confined to the within the box concept of location and immaterial. And you know, we could actually, when we consider our sources, what ideas have we hit upon to identify this source? I think if we were to look in the Bible, for instance, we could look various places, but I think that actually the very first verse tells it to us very straight, which states, Bereshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve'et ha'aretz. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and I think the whole answer is right there. In the beginning, that's time, God created the heavens, that's space, and the earth, and that's matter. Moreover, in the beginning, God, so he's already there, a pre-existing, transcendent cause, created, volitionally infused with energy, the heavens and the earth. And I like to refer to this as big mind theory, because what brought the universe into being had volition. Okay, that's the ability to plan, the ability to carry out the plan, and the exercise of will, by which I want to make sure we understand, I mean the ability to choose what is possible to do. And so right there in Genesis 1:1, we have in the beginning time, God, a pre-existent transcendent being, created, volitionally infused with energy, the heavens, space, and the earth matter. And it's all right there. It really is. And lastly, I'd like to say a word about fine-tuning or the anthropic principle, because as you can tell, while there are many reasons for holding to the multiverse theory, that is one of the major motivations, beyond that it troubles your worldview or all these various examples we heard, psychological factors, preferred theories, etc. The issue that is more so than anything else, it seems to me, fueling the multiverse theory is the attempt to deny fine-tuning. So first you deny fine-tuning, then when you can't deny it anymore, uh-oh, what do I do with it now? And so, well, you know, there's so many universes that, well, some are fine-tuned and some are not. We just happen to be in the one that is. And by the way, when it comes to materialism, atheism, etc., I think that's their bottom line answer to any and every ultimate question is, it just is. It just is. It just happened. It just happened to have happened that way. It just is. This one's fine-tuned for life. Well, we just happen to have gotten lucky in being in the one that's fine-tuned for life. Well, if it wasn't, we wouldn't be here to discuss it, would we? And so these two statements I found quite interesting. Edit Zahavi and Avishai Dekel in Nature write, this type of universe requires a degree of fine-tuning in the initial conditions that is apparent in conflict with common wisdom. And N. Strassman in European Journal of Physics wrote that we are confronted with a disturbing cosmic coincidence problem. And as I was preparing for this lecture, this line came to mind one day. Extraordinary fine-tuning requires an extraordinary fine-tuner. That's, I think, the logical conclusion. So I actually did not want to discuss fine-tuning in detail because, I mean, that would just, that's a whole big field and we could get really sidetracked. But I do want to hit some bullet points and I'll just go ahead and read them. The values of nature's fundamental constants, strong nuclear force constant, ratio of the electromagnetic force constant to gravitation constant, mass ratio of the electron and proton, ratio of protons to electrons, cosmic entropy level, fine structure constant, polarity of the water molecule, mass excess of the neutron over the proton, the initial excess of matter over antimatter, the sun's historical change in luminosity, which happens to coincide with the specific needs of Earth-based life forms. Galaxy type, if too elliptical, no heavy elements, if too irregular, radiation exposure. Supernovae eruptions, not too far or too close, not too infrequent, not too soon or late. Parent star distance from center of galaxy, number of stars in the planetary system, parent star age, parent star mass and color, surface gravity not too weak or not too strong, distance from parent star, too close burn up, too far away freeze to death, inclination and eccentricity of orbit, axial tilt, rotation period, asteroidal and cometary collision rate, the oxygen to nitrogen ratio and oxygen quality, global distribution of continents, Jupiter's distance, if too great, too many asteroids and comet collisions, if less, Earth gravity would become unstable. And I want to put particular emphasis on this one, oxygen, carbon dioxide, respiration exchange between plants and animals. Now, as far as I know, the person who actually conceived this one point makes the following point. Of all the available chemicals, and it needn't have been a gas, plants evolved, quote unquote, to utilize CO2 as a basis for the system. As this process was developing through eons of time, and that's a whole problem right there, to eventually become a functioning respiratory system and process and proceed to photosynthesis, a separate system was evolving alongside, i.e. animal respiration, which just by happenstance involves another gas, O2. How lucky and fortunate that both independent systems evolving alongside each other but totally disconnected and unaware of each other's presence and progress, evolution is a mindless phenomenon after all, managed to produce not only separate respiratory systems but complementary respiratory systems, in as much as the waste product of each is essential and is the essential requirement of the other. This screams an intelligent designer. And as far as I know, this person is the only one who has brought this point forth as a evidence of fine-tuning or an anthropic principle. And that person is the erudite elucidator of all things cosmogony, Mr. Roger Hall. Very nice. And he sent me that in an email, so I hope you don't mind. I read it right out of there. And he actually provided me these slides on anthropic principle. So, to give you a bottom line, five-step way of remembering how to deal with this issue, and based on a popular phrase of pop culture, I came up with what I call the five-finger death punch, the multiverse. And the first point is that it presupposes atheism or materialism, because according to this, nothing can count as evidence of intelligent fine-tuning. I mean, we could learn so much more about the exquisite fine-tuning in the universe, and it wouldn't matter. To them, it's just, oh, it just happens to be we're in that universe. Yep, nothing. Nothing would count whatsoever as evidence. Number two, there is no evidence for the multiverse. Sure, there's models, there's theories, and that's fine. Steve, don't miss it. Literally, five more minutes. Literally. Okay. Point three, it's atheist supernaturalism, okay? An unobserved realm out there of infinite possibilities. Fourth, it's illogical. And fifth, as stated before, it ends up proving God's existence. So, that's your five right there. And now I'd like to play a little clip from John Cleese as he plays the scientist.
Hello. We scientists have now located a gene which we scientists believe gives people the God gene releases chemicals into our body which create the impression that there is meaning in the universe. And this God gene is just here between the gene which we scientists now know makes us eat coconut ice cream after a fish dinner, and this gene here which causes people with weak egos to grasp around desperately for simple explanations. Now, the discovery of this God gene is a big step forward in our quest to show that every bit of human behavior can be explained away mechanically, because we've now also located the gene which makes some people believe that every piece of human behavior can be explained away mechanically. And it's here, right next to the gene that makes you go to see a Nicolas Cage movie, so puzzle solved, and right under this gene, which can cause you to forget that since the 1920s, quantum physics has destroyed forever the idea that everything can be explained mechanically. Now, the gene which causes us to forget this obvious fact is very dominant in some people, especially me. And we scientists now know that it's closely linked to this gene here, which gives you such a weak sense of self that you hang on to anything that makes you feel more secure emotionally, whether it's fundamentalist religion or a reductionist view of the universe, which is right over this gene here that makes you want to punch people in the head when they take the scientific process and subject it to their pathological literal mindedness. Thank you, I need you. And by the way, we now know that there is a gene that causes you to say, thank you, I needed that, just there, when you were punched in the head.
What we are left with is to consider the universe as it is in all its vastness and glory. Psalm 19 states, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. And Romans 1 states, since the creation of the world, his divine attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse, because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. And so, thank you very much. That's the end of the lecture. There's some contact info if you're interested. Thank you. So now, Q&A. I got A's if you got Q's. Yeah.
People that believe that matter is eternal, are they claiming that matter cannot be destroyed and converted to energy? And if that's true, are they denying the existence of the sun and atomic bombs and things like that?
They're using the term matter generically. I mean, ultimately what they're trying to get at is, look, it's eternal. Whatever it is in whatever form it may be, it's eternal. We don't have to appeal to God as an explanation because it's always been there. I mean, that's really the bottom line. And like I said, I run into that absolutely everywhere. So whether it's the steady state theory proper or just that claim. I mean, we heard Paul Davies discuss that, well, according to the more respectable, at least, Big Bang theories, it literally came from nothing. Okay, so you don't really have these ideas which at least used to be proposed so much, and they probably still are about, you know, the universe having once been compacted to the size of a period at the end of a sentence. I mean, that's, in the more respectable theories, that's not even the case, literally from nothing. So they want to rescue that. They want to say, no, eternal, whether it's energy or matter, something is eternal, and then something happened to something, and here we are, that kind of thing, yeah. Yes?
The multiverse theory stuff sounds like something right out of the Chronicles of Riddick. And you know, and I, you know, with all due respect to the scientists in the room, if all these guys are that you're quoting here are scientists, I have to thank God I'm not a scientist. But you know, it just amazes me some of the stuff that they come up with.
The point is, they have a worldview. And just like any other worldview, they're like glasses. And so everything they see is filtered through these glasses, model-dependent realism. And so that they can't allow themselves to reach certain conclusions because their theory, their model, their worldview says that's not possible. Okay, now, on another level, we're dealing with spiritual warfare, no question about it. On another level, that's really what you're dealing with. That's really what you're dealing with. Yeah, and on another note, you know, when you deal with atheists, as long as they throw out the word science, it's like, oh my, now we're really onto something, you know. Science, oh my, science, well, whatever you have to say has to be at least more respectable than theology.
That they have to have as much faith as I do in God. That they,
exactly, if not more so.
If not more so.
If I could just sit around thinking up these ideas and calling it a viable theory, hey. Anyhow, Roger?
In the multi-universe respect of entropy, and how do they have any answer or observation on increase of entropy within a universe, increase of entropy or decrease of entropy of the whole of multi-universes, and is that bounded? And what happens to entropy in that bounded system if it does exist in their mind? And also in the same question, in the increase of entropy or decrease of entropy, in case of the increase, where it's wound down, either singular or plural, what happens at the point of non-existence? Do more multi-universes then have to come into being? And where does that energy come from?
Sure.
In fact, you could just make one up out of the top of your head. Oh, entropy doesn't apply in the multiverse. There you go. I just made up a theory. But no, you have so many concepts. Then, in some, it's about dimensions. You know, in some, it's about branches. In some, it's about bubbles. And I think your question gets to one of the bottom line issues, which is, what are we actually talking about? I mean, what are we actually dealing with? Because we're talking about, oh, the multiverse exists and it's out there, and now what? And you're trying to get back to, well, how does the thing actually function? I mean, what breathes life into its equations, as Hawkins had said? You see what I'm saying? I don't think I have a real answer because it depends on which model you're talking about. The more popular models is basically that, well, some universes in the multiverse make it and some don't. You know, I mean, that's why evolution is being applied to it, because it's the same concept. Some survive, some don't. You know, you're talking about models on top of models on top of models. Yeah. Yes, sir.
One of your earlier slides was very revealing. It was that slide where you were summarizing the attributes of multiverse. Those last 5 points, omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. It's just sort of obvious to me that they have created their own God, because those are all the attributes of God. Mm-hmm. So they've simply created their own God, mm-hmm, rather than to accept the God of the Bible.
They changed the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible nature, let's say. Exactly. And you know, I deal with, from an apologetics point of view, I deal with atheism a lot. And the new atheism, in a sense, is becoming neo-pagan. Because they want to replace awe in God. They want to replace that with awe in nature. And when you hear them talk about nature, it's virtually the language of worship. Look what the multiverse has become, even though it's nothing but an idea. Or what nature and natural selection has produced. Look at these wonderful things it has done. It has done nothing, you know. But I call it neo-paganism because it truly is a new form of nature worship disguised as science or biology or whatever you want to call it. You're dead on. You're dead on, yes.
Are there any New Agers that adhere to a lot of multi-universes that think that after they die they, I don't know, merge with the universe or they're independently floating around or whatever or come back again?
Even more ethereal than these statements by scientists who are at least trying to make it appear respectable. I mean, it's time travel, it's UFOs, it's, you know, the aliens are just crossing dimensions. It's, oh yeah, I mean, it is all like the What the Bleep Do We Know, that documentary I mentioned. I mean, it's founded by a New Age foundation. Yes, a New Age, the concept of multiple universes, however you want to look at them as branches or parallels, however you want to, it's out there like you wouldn't believe. Oh, no question about it, yeah. Yeah, yes.
We know that the universe had a beginning and something had to cause that beginning. Have they considered, if there are multiple universes, there's something that caused each of those or some kind of mechanism or machine, and then what created that machine that caused all these multi-universes? I don't think they've really thought through the consequences of their belief system.
Well, I mean, each theory will attempt to deal with that question, but I don't think you ever get down to, at first there was nothing and then it exploded, you know. I mean, or branched, or bubbled, or whatever you want to call it. Since this is the idea we're trying to get away from, build all the multiverse models you want. We're not actually answering that fundamental question. I don't think we're actually answering it. We're pushing it back in time, we're pushing into another dimension, whatever, but it's still out there and it's undealt with. But what they would want to say is, well, you know, the stuff about causation, that's within this box, that's within this universe. Out there, anything and anything can happen, absolutely anything, like a multiverse coming from nothing or whatever, just make something up. And so now you're back to the argument against the multiverse, the logical argument.
We want to explain to them the universe that we have through the picture that Christ is telling us through the glasses, the biblical type glasses. And if we can explain it that way, we have some traction. We have something we can write into. And if we go these other directions, these people end up tearing us all different directions, and we really don't have anything to stand on.
Right, so the point is to not off into all these rabbit trails, but deal with the universe as is. And I completely agree with you. And that's why I'm going to grant them their theory just to the point where I can disprove it. But then I at the end, I'm going back to what? To the fine-tuning in our universe and to what the cause of the universe would look like and to actually identifying that it's the God of the Bible who fits the criteria. Yeah, your point is well made. We need to get back to what we know to be reality. We need to get back to things as they actually are and not find all these escape mechanisms and allow ourselves to get sidetracked all over the place by these various theories. Yes?
Just to reinforce what he was saying, of looking for counterfeit money, you don't study counterfeit money, you study the real thing. And we have the real thing.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
When you use the term multiverse, you seem to assume that meant infinite universes. Now, if I understand the fantasies of the string theory, they speak of finite universes.
Right.
Is that, is there a consensus to that or not?
I wouldn't know about consensus on that point, but that's why I made sure to say, look, if the person you're dealing with considers the multiverse to be infinite, here's how you deal with it. And if they consider it to be finite in number, here's how you deal with it. If they consider it finite in number, you tell them, okay, what are those universes like? And then however they begin to explain it, you know that they're just making something up that's convenient to their point of view. So the point being, either way, you have a logical disproof. Either way. But no, you're right. There's concepts out there, people claiming that they're infinite, and those that are not. Those that are infinite, well, anything and anything, everything happens. And those that are not, well, how many? Based on what? What are they like? You know, further speculation, further models. So yeah, when use the term multiverse or these other terms we covered, you could be dealing with either one of those. So yeah, that's something to ask if somebody starts talking to you about the multiverse. Ask them, well, just like with anything else, define your terms. What do you mean when you say that? And then take it from that perspective. But then, of course, always go back to the actual fine-tuning and how we can actually identify what the cause of the universe was like. You can apply Occam's razor to the multiverse. And from my perspective, supernaturalism is the default position. Now, many people would absolutely disagree with that and say, no, naturalism is. The supernatural is an addition to it. But the fact is, nature cannot explain itself. Right? The universe cannot explain itself. We know it had a beginning. And so naturalism is not the default position because there was something previous to it. That's what we call the supernatural. So supernaturalism is the default position. And nature is secondary to that. Yeah. Yes?
I was just going to say, the true body of Christ is not, the true body of Christ is not fractured. Okay? But we have a true body, we have a body of Christ that is fractured, extremely fractured. You can get a different flavor of Christianity on every other block, all right, in America and in the world. Do you think that if we weren't so fractured, that maybe, and we loved each other like the Bible tells us to love each other, that maybe, just maybe, they might take us as not so stupid and ignorant, because a lot of things that you said tonight, you can find a church in this city that does not believe in any of that heart of that stuff that you just read in scripture there.
Yeah.
You know, do you see what I'm saying?
Yes, exactly.
You know, they say, well, you say we're fractured, but guess what?
Yeah.
You're just as fractured. That's the truth.
Yeah.
You know, and it's bumfuck.
No, I hear you. If I can remember, there's
came to mind. One is, I remember hearing a radio show, a Christian radio show, and the person was talking about how, oh, the ACLU is just the worst organization in America. And I thought, okay, but I guarantee you there's at least a church out there that supports absolutely everything that the ACLU supports. Yes, exactly, just like you said. Secondly, we need to be careful about when we talk about what they view us as. I don't recall how you stated it. We got to think about what standards are we talking about. Would they consider us wise if we said, well, look, we believe in a nice story about God because it makes us feel good. But no, you're right about your worldly wisdom and your scientific knowledge. Yeah. And thirdly, you know, I once was getting on Facebook, and I didn't realize I was actually within my wife's account. So there was an atheist organization, and I said, oh, okay, I like them, because I like to sort of keep up with what's going on. And so she started getting all these messages from them. And I said, oops, I'm sorry. You can just hide or block or whatever they call it. She said, no, let me see what they have to say. And after a while, she said, man, all those guys ever talk about is Christianity. Not even just religion generically, but they're always against Christianity, always against Christianity. And atheism, I would say, is at least 99% anti-Christian, 1% anti-miscellaneous. And what I told her is, look, you're not going to go after something that's false as much as you're going to go after something that's true. And now that's true of us as rebellious sinners. That's true of spiritual warfare. That's true of what the enemy is doing out there in the world. Is let's go after Christianity 99%. Why? Because it's true.
Yeah. Amen.
And somewhere deep down in their soul, they know it. And it's the rebellion in them that would seek to make them discredit Christianity. And I'm not talking Christianity or religion. I'm talking Christianity being Christ-like, being followers of the Messiah. And just like Jesus said in John 3, light has come into the world, but men love darkness because their deeds are evil. He who does the deeds of God come into the light so that it might be seen that they're doing, right? So when you, people in darkness want to stay in darkness because if they go into the light, their sin would be exposed, okay? So when you speak truth to them, you shine that little light on them. It's like if you're asleep and someone turns on the light, you go, oh, no, turn that off, turn that off. Or the scripture says to be salt. If you've been in the ocean, ooh, all of a sudden, I didn't know I had that little scratch or cut here, but boy, that salt is really irritating it. Yeah, it hurts, but what's the salt doing? It's cleaning it out. And so when you light this, shine the light on truth on somebody, their reaction isn't, oh, how wonderful, my rebellion and sin is being exposed, and now I can, you know, it's more likely that they'll say, now they're mad at you, and now you're the ignoramus, and you need to, yeah, because you're bothering me with that light you're shining on me, yes. Thank you. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.